For thousands of years, God has guided, fed, educated, disciplined, chastised, and judged His people according to His holy will and His law as given in both the Old and New Testaments. In ancient time, it was the likes of Abraham, to whom He entrusted His people, then Moses, and a long list of other prophets and popes He sent to guide mankind. God so loved the world, He later sent His only Son to suffer and be sacrificed on the cross for the sins of others and the salvation of mankind. During the approximately 5,000 years of history, countless regimes have risen to great heights, only to be destroyed under the weight of their own disordered behavior. In biblical times, we have the example of Sodom and Gomorrah, where Abraham begged God not to destroy the city if just a few right-thinking, moral people could be found. But not 10 were found, and the cities were completely destroyed. The inhabitants were arrogant, did not help the poor, and performed all manner of unclean acts in the sight of God. When a group of citizens were told there were angels in the city, their only interest was to have sex with them. Rome, the most advanced civilization of its time, ruled the world for over 400 years, also fell into ruin, and was conquered by its enemies after years of wallowing in serious sin. During the last years of its rule, Rome was characterized by significant immorality and violence, including mass murder. The slaughter of Christians by wild animals in the Colosseum was common in order to distract citizens from its unending wars, inflation, military losses, debt, and corrupt politicians. During the decline, excessive taxes fueled a vast gap between the rich and poor, further giving rise to revolt. Its pagan religion, which worshipped the emperor as divine, crumbled in the face of Christianity, when later, thanks to Emperor Constantine, became the state religion in 380 AD after 300 years of persecution. In Rome, we see a parallel to today in terms of corrupt politics, moral degradation, huge increases in debt, loss of confidence in leaders. In the cases of Sodom, Greece, Rome, the British Empire, and other nation-states, a strong military, expansion, financial success, and prosperity were not enough to save them, and were destroyed by corruption, revolt of the people, and moral decay. The phrase, "those who ignore the lessons and mistakes of history are destined to repeat them," was true in ancient times and remains true today. These ancient nation-states ignored the past, just as we are testing the patience of Almighty God as never before. If we have learned nothing by the lessons of others, it should be obvious that God does not punish without warning and provides signs and messages through His prophets, the Church, saints, the Blessed Mother, and Jesus Himself to lay people and the religious alike to get people to change their behavior. An excellent historical example was the Jews' struggle to be released from slavery in Egypt, and Moses' many warnings to Pharaoh to free them or be punished. God sent sign after sign and plague after plague. The stubborn Pharaoh did not relent until God took His only child. The real point here is that God does not act to discipline His children without always providing many signs and warnings. In the history of the United States, there has never been a time when a country so blessed by God have so many in government, education, entertainment, the media, industry, science, the church, and individually turned both the teachings of God and their own behavior in terms of right and wrong completely upside down. Progressives often justify this behavior as forward-thinking, economically or scientifically sound, a human right, and other lies to sell their ideas to the public. While there have been many beneficial advances in science, medicine, technology, transportation, and elsewhere, there are an unequaled number of horrific attacks on the teachings of God and the moral fabric of the country, particularly the family. In the last two centuries, the warnings about our past, current, and future behavior have come in many forms. In 1830 in France, the Blessed Virgin Mary appeared to St. Catherine Labouret and requested the creation of the miraculous medal for special graces and protection, but also warned of the evils of the day. And that evil would increase significantly throughout France and elsewhere. France, for centuries, was the stronghold of the Catholic Church, known as the eldest daughter of the Church, but was singled out by the Blessed Mother as a center of evil during this period. In 1895, renowned stigmatist Maria Julia Jehanie reinforced the Blessed Mother's message about France as a center of evil, stating it was destined to be chastised based on its promotion of humanism, feminism, modernism, and liberal Catholic thinking contrary to church doctrine. In 1846, and again in 1864, at La Salette in France, the Blessed Virgin said,
"The demons of the air, together with the Antichrist, will perform great wonders on earth and in the atmosphere, and men will become more and more perverted." In the year 1864, Lucifer, together with a large number of demons, will be unloosed from hell. They will put an end to faith, little by little, even in those dedicated to God. They will bind them in such a way that unless they are blessed with a special grace, these people will take on the spirits of the angels of hell.
In 1884, Pope Leo XIII, after Holy Mass, reportedly was permitted by God to overhear a conversation between God and the devil, in which the evil one asked for and was given a certain period of time to test mankind and the Church. It is believed that that time period is reaching a crescendo during the present day. Immediately after, Pope Leo created a special prayer for the Church, invoking the protection of Saint Michael the Archangel, which for 100 years was said after Mass by the faithful. Regrettably, it is no longer recited in most parishes. The apostasy of France was a great disappointment to the Virgin Mary, as she was instrumental in the growth of the Church in France, appearing to individuals many times, beginning in 47 AD at Le Puy. Mary Magdalene, who lived out her final years in France, was also instrumental in the growth of the early Church in the southern region of Provence. Also at La Salette, the Virgin Mary said that an unleashing of evil would coincide with
a frightful crisis in the Church, a great rise in frivolous amusements, seasons that would be altered, and occult phenomena such as voices in the air, and that people would be transported from one place to another by these evil spirits.
In 1882, prophet and stigmatist Maria Julia Jehanie warned that when bishops begin to split with the Pope, there will be a schism in the Church that Jesus will not forgive and chastisements will follow. Shortly after the Blessed Mother's appearance at La Salette, and again after her appearance and messages at Fatima in Portugal in 1917, a vicious epidemic of influenza spread throughout France and Europe, killing millions. So again, we see God acting as always, first warning, giving miraculous signs, more warnings and signs, and finally, chastisement comes to his children. Because previous messages and warnings had little effect on the sinful behavior of mankind, the messages, warnings, and chastisements mentioned by Mary at Fatima, Portugal, in 1917, were perhaps the most serious of all, indicating coming world wars, financial chaos, and corruption of the Catholic Church, should mankind continue on its sinful path. All predictions, unfortunately, came true beginning with World War I in 1917, followed by the stock market crash in 1929, a 10-year worldwide depression in the 1930s, and then World War II, which the U.S. entered in 1942, in which 70 million died. During this period, direct orders from Stalin and Hitler resulted in 30 million of their own citizens slaughtered. After World War II, we entered a period of relative calm, as rebuilding began in Europe, and there was significant economic growth in the U.S. There was also a baby boom, as soldiers returned home, married, and had families. There was great movement into the suburbs, growth in housing, giving rise to a population explosion in what came to be known as the baby boomer generation. After the war, baby boomers in the 1950s grew up in a period associated with traditional values in the United States. Unfortunately, this relatively peaceful, mild decade soon gave way to the 60s, where things began to rapidly change with the advent of the rock and roll generation, which began in the late 50s and which resulted in many other structural changes in a more permissive society. By the mid-1960s, vastly different programming was appearing on television, in movies, and magazines, where suddenly an emphasis on sex and violence took on greater prominence. Foul language became more prevalent, and the Leave It to Beaver family attitude of the 1950s began to change. As quoted by Spirit Daily, sexual abuse in the church germinated in the 1950s and 60s as society itself sank into the abyss of various temptations. Suddenly, many men and women with homosexual tendencies and New Age proclivities entered seminaries and joined orders, in fulfillment of what the Virgin Mary said in La Salette back in 1846. Her words were,
"The devil will resort to all his evil tricks to introduce sinners into religious orders, for disorder and the love of carnal pleasures will be spread over all the earth. The more damaged the church is, the more damaged the world will become. Whether it's the economy, military conflict, civil unrest, natural disasters, or the environment."
The immorality in the world is exponentially greater than that in the church, and if trends continue, results will be catastrophic. The problems of the priesthood born in secret over 50 years ago have now been fully exposed, giving rise to the biggest scandal since the Reformation, and threatens the moral authority of the Church as never before. Adding to the problem, the Second Vatican Council of Pope John in 1962 had noble intentions to modernize some aspects of the Church, but not Church doctrine. Unfortunately, some conclusions of the Council were misinterpreted by liberals in and outside the church in terms of Catholic doctrine, which continue to cause confusion today. There was a popular saying among hippies in the free love 60s, "If it feels good, do it," which coincidentally was vastly similar to the phrase that Aleister Crowley, known as the father of Satanism, used, went something like, "Do what thy will do," meaning do it and don't sweat the consequences. Self-gratification is king. This philosophy can be traced to the 1700s and the French Revolution, which ended the reign of King Louis XVI and the French monarchy. This revolution in France were the beginnings of humanism, feminism, and modernism, all which seek to promote individual freedoms and progressive individual rights above all else. For the next 40 years, extreme liberals, now called progressives, clearly influenced by the evil one, have attacked both the teachings of the church and Judeo-Christian traditions on many fronts, not the least of it which is their attack on the traditional family unit. The strategy to achieve their objectives of undermining the family has been to normalize what traditionally has been viewed as taboo, inconceivable, illegal, or distasteful, and importantly, to diminish the moral authority of the church. Clearly, this did not happen all at once, but has been like a faucet, slowly dripping into a pot of water, until eventually the pot overflows which is exactly where we are today in 2019. In terms of marriage and the family, one of the first attacks involved divorce, which traditionally was rare and frowned upon, but which over a period of years became more and more acceptable and attainable. Today, divorce carries little societal repudiation, and currently 50% of marriages end in divorce. What once was inviolate can now be legally achieved in 30 days in some states. Sadly, the impact on children is significant, regardless of how friendly the divorce. Today, the seriousness of a marital commitment has been seriously diminished and turned upside down. What we're seeing play out now is good versus evil in its final form. This is the evil one working to turn God's children against him in every conceivable way by marginalizing his church, his priests, his teachings, and his children. Now is the time to choose not to be led by the upside-down thinking of progressives who promote the individual rights above all else. This has also been the credo of the New Age movement, which wants to convince people that while God may exist, you are the center of your own universe. Do we need to look any further than social media to see the obsessive glorification and the focus on self and self-absorption? Although abortion continues to be legal in this country, there is clearly movement in the direction of limiting abortion, moving towards making it legal. Unfortunately, New York State has gone to the extreme of passing a law contrary to federal guidelines, permitting abortion even in the ninth month. Others are working on laws indicating that if a baby is born alive after an abortion, it can't be given life-saving measures. There is no other way to say it other than we are living in a country that promotes child sacrifice, otherwise known as infanticide. This puts us in the same place as ancient Israel, where children were sacrificed at the altar of the pagan god Baal, so the parents would be blessed with good things in their lives. The king of Israel was warned that if he allowed child sacrifice to continue, he would be killed. Instead of God, he obeyed his wife, who promoted the murder of innocents, and he was killed. Shortly after, Israel was conquered. A replica of the Temple of Baal, symbol of child sacrifice, has been exhibited in New York and Washington, D.C. in 2018 and 2019. America upside down. There are individuals who have no problem with this murderous tool of abortion to weed out children by gender should they discover a girl when they actually want a boy, as the Chinese have done for decades. On the subject of gender selection, science through gene research and experimentation can possibly offer parents what are referred to as designer babies, who would be both physically and mentally designed to offer the greatest possibility for good looks, acceptance, success, and popularity. Science experimentation with the human genome, including the cloning of animals and gene and crop manipulation, is a horrible affront to Almighty God, who is the creator of all things. This diabolical work is, of course, justified by progressives and science as having great value in the fields of health, increasing longevity and resistance of crops to disease, and many other things. Again, the evil one is working hard in these areas to show mankind they don't need a creator because science and technology has all the answers. We already know manipulation of mass food production has reduced the nutrition value of some foods and possibly caused disease. This has led to a boom in products grown organically as people sense something is not right with the food supply. The long-term effects of crop manipulation on health are completely unknown and very risky, and the manipulation of human genes is an absolutely horrifying affront to God. We can definitely expect consequences. There has long been a diabolical attack on the traditional family, using the strategy of normalizing behavior, particularly on same-sex marriage, to the point where the definition of family is now a confused jumble. Children in each group born in one, adopted in another, procured from sperm banks or from surrogates, and confusion reigns. Drip, 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 up is down. Versus thousands of years of family history, this society has also managed to completely confuse children about their identity, their gender, and their place in society. Some parents are even waiting to see what gender or genders their children would like to choose before they fill out their child's birth certificate. The state of New York now has 31 different categories people can choose from. Lastly, could there be anything more cruel and confusing than giving little children at school bathroom options and letting them try to figure out which one to choose on any particular day? Up is down. There are very serious gender disorders from sex change surgeries, and gender suicides are rampant in the transgender community. In fact, as reported in Spirit Daily, Dr. Paul McHugh shut down the transgender surgical program at Johns Hopkins Hospital, stating, "You simply cannot transform the mentality of a male to female, and vice versa." In fact, over 50% of adolescents who participated in female-to-male transformation attempted suicide. The media, however, never report these tragic consequences. During the past 50 years, with exceptions, no industry has been more complicit in eroding the moral fabric of America than the media, in all forms, with particular emphasis on television and movies from Hollywood. While nudity-oriented magazines like Playboy and others had an impact on morality in the 60s and 70s, it was minimal when compared to the impact of television and movies, which year by year become more aggressive in explicit sex scenes, outright pornography, and extreme violence. Again, with few exceptions, the mainstream media has walked hand in hand with progressives and modernists in support of the progressive agenda, from unlimited abortion to the normalization of all forms of sexual behavior, to attacks on the teachings of the church, and much more. The U.S. has sadly become the leading provider of pornography in the world. Clearly, not a record America should be proud of. Drip, drip, drip. Another example of America upside down. We serve a loving, merciful, patient God who is the ultimate believer in forgiveness and asks us to do the same. Throughout history, God has shown to nation after nation that there is a limit to his patience, and at some point when the line has been crossed too many times in the drip, drip, drip of serious sin, God's mercy gives way to his justice. He will send messages and warnings to correct us when we stray from the path of righteous behavior, and during the past 38 years has been doing just that in a place called Medjugorje in Bosnia-Herzegovina. During this time, God has permitted his mother Mary to appear in this tiny village to what were six children who are now adults, giving them messages of God's love for all of us and asking for prayer, fasting, peace, and conversion. Medjugorje is the longest series of apparitions in history and has been visited by 40 million pilgrims from all over the world. During December 2009, Cardinal Christoph Schönborn, Bishop of Vienna and close friend of Pope Benedict, made a personal pilgrimage to Medjugorje, site for 29 years of reported apparitions of the Blessed Virgin Mary. The bishop granted interviews during and after his visit, which appear to have clearly helped elevate attention to Medjugorje at the Vatican. The bishop mentioned he has personally witnessed the good fruits of Medjugorje in his own diocese and elsewhere via many conversions, spiritual healings, recovering drug addicts, and new vocations. Also, having been to other major apparition sites like Lourdes and Fatima, Schoenborn views Medjugorje as one of the world's most important pilgrimage locations. During his visit at Christmas, he was quoted as saying, "The fruits of Medjugorje are so impressive, it is hard to say they are not from God." As the Blessed Mother's messages and requests for prayers, fasting, reconciliation, penance, and peace were made known to the people, the first outward signs that people were listening was a significant increase in praying the rosary and a dramatic, overwhelming increase in confessions being heard in Medjugorje. Soon, priests speaking many different languages were needed to hear confessions next to St. James. This practice resulted in the building of various confessionals you see here to deal with the most gratifying increase in the sacrament. This, of course, resulted in people by the thousands reconciling with God, their families, and their neighbors.
I invite you to call on everyone to pray the rosary. With the rosary, you shall overcome all adversities which Satan is trying to inflict on the Catholic Church. All you priests, pray the rosary. Dedicate your time to the rosary. This message Our Lady gave in response to the question of Maria Pavlovich. Our Lady, what do you wish to recommend to priests? Dear children, in the great love of God, I come to you today to lead you on the way of humility and meekness. The first station on that way, my children, is confession. Reject your arrogance and kneel down before my Son. Comprehend, my children, that you have nothing and you can do nothing. The only thing that is yours and what you possess is sin. Be cleansed and accept meekness, humility, and love. Follow my Son and give me your hands so that together we may climb the mountain and win.
There have been numerous physical healings reported, but more importantly, millions have returned to their faith and commandments and returned home renewed in spirit. It is believed that many in our country, individually and in various interest groups, are behaving in ways that are bringing America as a nation to a point where so many great civilizations of the past, like Egypt, Israel, Rome, and others, have found themselves. For at least the time of the French Revolution, the Virgin Mary at La Salette and her messengers like Maria Julia Jehany, Sister Lucy at Fatima, and more recent messages at Medjugorje tell us we are closer to inviting severe chastisement and final judgment than ever before. In addition to signs in the sky and dramatic changes in weather patterns, some of the most significant warnings in the past 20 years have come from an Irish mystic named Christina Gallagher, who, based on messages from Jesus and Mary, predicted many significant events in advance, which occurred as she said they would. Some of these predictions include the destruction of the Twin Towers on September 11, 2001. The stock market crash of 2008, and the 2004 tsunami in the Indian Ocean, which killed 230,000 people. In September of 2018, Ms. Gallagher received an urgent message and request from Jesus for the people of New York, who Jesus referred to as Man of Sorrow, saying, among other things, "My people of New York City, you fail to hear and take heart my call. Your life is so busy with everything of the world and that of the flesh. I do not exist in your lives, but when the chain of power begins, you will realize how foolish you have been. Listen in humility to my wisdom through my messenger regarding the existence of New York, for it will be disintegrated to a non-existence while you are asleep, and it is too late to awake you. The time is now. Your time is short. I will not call again. Turn to me while you still have time. I love you. Accept me as your Lord and Savior. Jesus asked Christina to raise funds to have a house of prayer built in the outskirts of New York, similar to houses of prayer
she has built in Ireland, Florida, Texas, and Minnesota,
for the specific purpose of prayer for the conversion of the people of New York so that they can avoid disaster.
During a visit to New York in early October 2019, Mrs. Gallagher related messages and prophecy on a variety of very important subjects pertaining to the United States and elsewhere. Here is a portion of her talk which begins with her discussing the shifting of various plates under the earth, which are in danger of causing quakes in many places.
And as I so often experienced a noise and crackling, for going back for months now, of the plates, and there's one on the verge of slipping to go under, and if it goes under in this particular place, I feel that there could be an enormous tsunami. For who, is it worldwide or America or the bordering countries? I don't know, but I do know there's going to be a huge earthquake very, very soon in California. Now this is just like the Twin Towers. I am saying it as certain as I'm stood here. But just like our Lord wants to protect New York, but it's as if I read from what I hear from the Lord, California is nearly gone beyond saving, because there's no one that has time for light, only darkness. And the place is saturated in such filth through sin, beyond any place. And that says a lot, because New York is not an awful lot behind it, but yet the Lord cries out and sees his mercy, a hope through people that want through their free will to save New York. There are other parts of America, as he said, you know, when you hear this climate change, it's utter nonsense. Nothing so much greater rubbish. It's the hand of God coming upon the world that's coming to crush sin that's taking place. And the melting of the ice and all that's happening is as the earth recognizes its creator. And it will get worse, and so will all the activity of the earth. Like when I was told that the twisters and the different things would be in unfamiliar places. Shortly after, there was twisters and I forget what storms there was now in Ireland, in Belmullet. Mudslides, yes. And pulled some of the land away, which there was a graveyard. And it pulled some of the graveyard into the sea. Will that likewise, but in a much greater way, will happen round the coastline, and especially in California. And there'll be many chunks of the coastline just torn into the sea. I wish you didn't, well, you won't, have the extent of the awareness and knowledge that I have of what is coming to the world, and to how unprepared people are, both to do anything about it, even to listen. People are not even prepared to listen, never mind to act or do something about it. But I am helpless. All I can do is relate what's given to me, and then the choice is yours. Thank you.
prophecies given to Christina by Jesus as far back as 1995 and again in 2006, indicating that fire would rage in North America are being fulfilled in California. An additional message was given to Christina on October 12, 2019, which stated, California flames will rise high upon all those filled with their own pomp and false security. So many in their pride adore the world and its fruits. All that is not of me is wasting away. These fires are little. There will be many more until they open their hearts to recognize my hand crushing evil. Tell the people of California they must honor me, their God. Jesus and Mary's warnings to Christina Gallagher have now become reality. The coronavirus. On July 16, 2002, the Blessed Virgin Mary said, "Diseases will fall upon many, plagues will devour many." On February 22, 2005, Jesus said, "There will be an epidemic throughout the world, with a germ bred through AIDS. Many innocent people will catch it and die. There will be a virus-type plague, which will kill many throughout the world." On January 26, 2013, Jesus said, "The world will endure many diseases and plague diseases that will be man-made." The virus is now a worldwide pandemic killing many thousands of people, swarms of locusts. On March 29, 2009, the Blessed Virgin Mary said, "Locusts, such as has never been seen before, will form a plague. It will seem as if they themselves have an evil intent, as if they have an awareness. They are to wreak destruction." In October 2012, Jesus said, "My people, hear and respond as I have called you. Worse turmoil is on the way. Locusts will come and devour you while you are spiritually asleep. Swarms of voracious locusts, floods, and food shortages in East Africa are affecting 10 million people in Ethiopia, Somalia, Kenya, South Sudan, who now face unprecedented difficulty." The Bible teaches that a bad tree cannot bear good fruit, nor can a good tree bear bad fruit. And by their fruits you shall know them. Clearly, the fruits of Christina Gallagher's ministry in the houses of prayer have been good not only through the validation of her predictions, but importantly, because of the large number of spiritual conversions and physical healings from Almighty God. Here are two of them.
In a few moments, some of the people who have been healed, these are people of the hundreds who have been healed, whose cases have been investigated in depth by medical experts. And one of the doctors involved will also speak to us. I would like then to introduce Kathleen O'Sullivan from Listowel in County Kerry. Kathleen was given up or dead. Her file was put with the deceased. There were three consultants treating her. One is a professor of medicine in the National University of Ireland. She was only 5 stone weight when she was sent home to die. Her husband had just heard of the House of Prayer here in Achill. She had been given a Matrix medal, which is the medal Our Lady gave for conversion and protection through Christina. Her husband felt he had nothing to lose. The case was utterly hopeless. And he drove her here. She was lying under a duvet in the back seat of the car. She couldn't even sit up. She hadn't been able to take solid foods. When he carried her in his arms, for Christina to pray with her and brought her into the chapel here, she was instantaneously healed. When she came out, she wanted to sit in the front seat of the car, and as they approached Galway on their way back to Kerry, she said she felt hungry and could they have something to eat. She ate a full meal, and ever since, day by day, week by week, she grew perfectly strong and healthy, better than she had ever been before she had the diseases. Dr. Michael Anquetil, whom I will also introduce to you here today, sent her back after he heard, on the occasion of a visit here on pilgrimage, after he heard of this healing. Being a doctor, he knew that pancreatic cancer advances painlessly. Then he sent her back to each of the consultants again to undergo the tests. And they wrote their reports after careful examination and analysis and found that there was no medical, scientific, human, or psychological explanation for her healing. I just invite Kathleen now to come forward and say a little prayer of thanksgiving.
After an ultrasound, Mrs. Finola McManus's doctor told her the baby in her womb was lifeless and would have to be removed. But Finola refused the procedure until she could pray with Christina Gallagher at the House of Prayer in Achill, Ireland, which she did. On her return to the hospital, an ultrasound was performed, and to the absolute astonishment of the doctors and nurses, a heartbeat was discovered. A month later, a perfectly healthy baby was born, remaining so today. God is slow to anger and full of forgiveness and mercy for his people. A great example of his mercy is allowing the Blessed Virgin Mary to be available to us as our spiritual guide, teacher, and mother for almost 40 years in Medjugorje. Along the way, pilgrims stop to do the Stations of the Cross, and always they pray the Rosary. Some years ago, a large statue of Mary was placed at the top of Apparition Hill, where the children first saw her. The climb and summit of both hills are a time of prayer, of contemplation, and of solitude, as pilgrims seek a deeper relationship with God. Mary begs us to heed her call, to fast and pray her rosary, to show by our lives how to live the messages and receive the peace. This is clearly the way home.
Your arms strong yet gentle, you love the humble too. You fill the yearning spirit, the poor reach to you. Then she smiled so softly at this mystery. My God's kept his promise, and he's chosen me.
the ultimate parent, God, the Father, wants us with Him in paradise and, in order to get us there, continues to teach, warn, chastise, forgive, and ultimately judge. He continues to show His love and mercy for us in places like Medjugorje and elsewhere. At the same time, dire warnings are also being given, along with signs that all is not right in the world. In fact, far from it, for all the reasons we have mentioned, including abortion on demand, erosion of the family, disordered sexual behaviors, gender confusion of children, genetic manipulation, shootings and mass murder, assisted suicide, media promotion of sex and violence, marginalizing the poor, human trafficking, man's inhumanity to man. Lastly, the corruption of the Catholic Church from within is no small matter, and the purification of the Church is expected to continue for a period of time. Spirit Daily writes, in 2006, Jesus Himself said the following to a Polish mystic, "My Church suffers as I suffered. It is wounded and bleeds, as I was wounded and marked the way to Golgotha with my blood. It is spat upon and defiled, and it succumbs and falls as I, under the burden of the cross, did, because it also carries the cross of my children through the years and ages. It gets up and walks towards resurrection through Golgotha and crucifixion. The dawn of the Holy Church is coming, although there is an anti-church, and its founder is the Antichrist. It is likely the evil one will be allowed to continue to tempt mankind, and equally clear that unless we seriously amend our behavior, we will have a weakened church, increased persecution of Christians, financial problems, more wars, and an increase in natural disasters. We also know the evil one's time is rapidly coming to an end as Jesus' return to thwart him grows ever closer. Jesus, Mary, and the popes, and many priests have told us that prayer can dramatically change both our lives and major events for good. Some years ago, Pope John Paul II said, "Prayer can alleviate the tribulation that is to come, but it is no longer possible to avert it completely." So do not despair. Do not lose faith. God is with you, as is the Blessed Mother, the angels, and saints. Call on them often. They will help you in whatever you need, and by all means do what the Blessed Mother asks constantly in Medjugorje. And pray, pray, pray for one another, the Church, and for America.